All right, let us turn our hearts to worship God. Let us use the call to worship that is printed in the bulletin. On this Father's Day, we come to worship the God and Father of us all. God nurtures, protects, welcomes, forgives, calls, challenges, and loves us. We come to worship our Heavenly Father, who has created us and creates us anew. We give thanks for our earthly fathers, who love in the image of our Creator God.
All right, good morning. It's great to have everybody here. If you all would please stand and join us in our opening song.
Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see. Alone. left your home to seek out the lost. You knew the grave and terrible cause, but Jesus, your face was sad. I worked my fingers down to the bone. Nothing I did could ever atone. But Jesus, you made my death. By your blood I have redemption and salvation. Lord, you died that I might reap what you have sown. Creation. I am born again by grace and grace alone. I was in darkness all of my life. I never knew the day from the night. Your Spirit, you made me see. I swore I knew the way on my own. Head full of rocks and heart made of stone. The Spirit, you moved in me. And that good Spirit was awakened. On my darkened heart, the light of Christ has shone. Heaven's citizen by grace and grace alone. For I stand in faith by grace and grace alone. I will run the race by grace and grace alone. I will slay my sin by grace and grace alone. I will reach the end by grace and grace alone.
Inspired to go out and share your love in the world. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Oh, Covenant and remember to do his commandments. And the entirety of the 127th Psalm, maybe. Unless the Lord builds the house, those who build it labor in vain. Unless the Lord guards the city, the guard keeps watch in vain. It is in vain that you rise up early and go late to rest, eating the bread of anxious toil, for he gives sleep to his beloved. Sons are indeed a heritage from the Lord, the fruit of the womb a reward. Like arrows in the hand of a warrior are the sons of one's youth. Happy is the man who has a quiver full of them. He shall not be put to shame when he speaks with his enemies in the gate. The word of the Lord.
So I'm continuing this sermon series, the Psalms, and in doing that, Father's Day offered a theme for this Father's Day sermon, using the Psalms that have connections with fathers. And I will also say that this is one way of studying Scripture and studying especially the Psalms, in addition to like studying from, you know, 1 to 150 and just going straight through and learning about them. Or like last week, I talked about the different types of psalms, like praise psalms or lament or worship or royal psalms or something like that, talking about themes and going across that way. This is another way to study the psalms. It is topically or by theme. You choose a theme, whatever that may be, like love or peace or justice or nature or courage, any theme that you choose. And then you read through the psalms that relate to that theme, that talk about that topic, to see what inspires you and how God speaks to you. A concordance or a topical Bible will do that for you. There are also even those online that will help you trace through and find out themes for different scripture passages. So today's topical study of the psalms is all about fathers. The psalms we just heard all talk about fathers in one way or another. Their compassion, their purpose in teaching and providing for their children, the guidance God gives to faithful fathers in how to live and how to build a strong and fruitful household, all of that is in these psalms. Two of the psalms also talk about God as Father, the ultimate caregiver, the one, the example that we have in God Almighty, whom we call Father, and who is also a father of the fatherless, as the psalm says, Father of every person in the entire world, our Father as well. We know God's love as a father, as a parent. That is the most intimate, caring love that you can imagine, or even more than we can imagine. And we are children of God, heirs of God. We inherit gifts from God. And by learning from God, just as children learn from their parents, we hope, by learning from God how to love and how to care, we can learn to be the best possible people that we can be. Fathers can model their own fatherhood on God's fatherhood, on the sacrificial, loving, unending, unconditional love of God. It's a tall order to model yourself on God, to try to be like God, to love as God loves. But that kind of love, God believes we are capable of that kind of loving and giving. We can love like God loves. We can follow Jesus Christ, Scripture tells us. We can try to reflect the image of God, which God created us to be. So today, we honor that kind of love, that kind of connection. Now, fatherhood is all over the Bible, from beginning to the end. There are countless passages, countless stories of describing what makes a good father. Or for that matter, there are countless stories about what makes a really bad father. There's some bad examples of fatherhood in Scripture as well. In most cases, in the Bible, a good father is one who models faithfulness, who is kind and generous as God is. Likewise, from Genesis to Revelation, God is referred to as a father. Or the image, there are images that are used in Scripture that reflect being a good father, that God is described in that way. And we, of course, know that Jesus called God Abba, Father. which is a very tender, intimate family name, like Daddy or Papa, very close connection. And it is natural for us to call God Father. We do it in our many of our prayers. We often begin calling God Father, knowing that, reminding ourselves of that connection. It helps us to understand who God is. It helps us to connect to God. Father God is a part of our everyday language and thought. Very familiar, very fitting to call God Father. In today's scripture from the Psalms, there are several references to fatherhood. I want to look at the Psalms one by one, but we won't look at them chronologically. We'll look at them according to the themes that relate to fathers. So, begin with Psalm 127, which is the last one. And they are printed inside the bulletin, so you feel free to follow along as I talk about them. Psalm 127. This psalm is only 5 verses long, and so it is one of the shorter psalms in our Bible, one of the shorter chapters in our Bible. It's probably also believed to be one of our older psalms, written even before David, and it is built on the model of wisdom literature, wisdom psalms in the Bible. Wisdom literature includes things like the Proverbs. So if you see that whole of 127, it doesn't completely tie together. There are thoughts that are connected, but it doesn't flow freely. Wisdom literature gives practical advice. That's, if you think about any of the Proverbs, it is practical advice about how to live. Wisdom literature is supposed to be something that you can recognize in teaching you how to live. And in the same way, in some ways, the verses are separate thoughts strung together to connect around the theme. Psalm 127 begins by giving advice about how to be a good father, or how to be the head of a household. And that is to invite God to be the head of the household, to invite God to build the house. God should build every house. God should guard every city. God should be in charge of our lives, basically, is what it's saying. So a good father is one who recognizes God's leadership and not only goes where God leads, but encourages the whole household to follow and to go where God is leading. Everyone should model on this, how to live faithfully. And a good parent will encourage the whole household, all the children and all the relatives, to follow God in the same way. The last part of the psalm is a reflection of the joy of being a father, being a parent. Sons are a heritage and a reward from God. This does reflect the times, of course, because today we would say sons and daughters are a blessing from God. A delight now and a source of blessing in the future. The last line about not being put to shame is the ultimate goal of that day, of life in that day. To be honored would bring happiness. To be put to shame would be a disgrace. So the goal of life was to be honored and not put to shame. The psalm uses rather utilitarian language there at the end, comparing children to arrows in a quiver. Useful, purposeful, the more you have, the better. Again, that might not be consistent with today's thought. I don't think also that the analogy holds, as many analogies don't, that children are expendable like arrows or don't have their own will, because we know that they do. That's often true of analogies, that they don't follow through, they're not perfect. But the image is descriptive. Everyone would know what a quiver full of arrows in that day would look like and what it would mean, providing protection and safety. It would be full, it would be positive. How hard it would be to come up with a full quiver of arrows. How useful it would be to take care of the family. Again, times have changed. We have other ways of measuring honor today and value today. But the overall sentiment stands. Children are a blessing. Fathers can be proud of their families. And back to that first verse, the most important part of this, God should be the center of the household. God builds our families and strengthens our household. Good mothers and good fathers know that. Good mothers and good fathers follow God's lead. So moving on to Psalm 78, is another psalm that gives advice about how to be a good father, not fatherhood. We didn't hear the whole of the psalm. In fact, there were 72 verses, so we're really glad you didn't hear the whole psalm. But this is the introduction section of this psalm. These first verses talk about how important it is to teach children about God, to tell people about the history of our faith, the history of our families, to instruct families in God's way, how important that is. That is the key role of faithful fathers and mothers. Teach your children well. Teach our children well. In fact, the rest of Psalm 72 that we didn't read is kind of a history lesson. If you read through it, it's about some particular incident in the history of Israel. And if you remember, the psalms are often originally music. So imagine that this kind of psalm is kind of a ballad that goes on and on, telling a story. The Ballad of Egypt and Israel and God Most High. And if you read through the whole of the psalm, it continues that way. Come, listen, my children, hear this, it might say. Listen and learn and be faithful. And it tells us how important it is to learn God's ways. But these first verses are the introduction to the ballad, and they concentrate on how important it is for parents to teach children, that the next generation will know all about God and will follow God's ways. And the last verse is the cautionary tale about what happens if you don't teach your children, how the next generation will be lost if we don't teach and share what we know to be true of God's law. Incidentally, to aside, that's often a warning, but we also have confidence that God's got it, and it will not, God's love of us will not be lost, and it will continue. Just calling us to be a part of that sharing generation to generation. Bottom line for fathers, for parents today, is verse 4. We will teach, we will tell to the coming generation the glorious deeds of the Lord and God's might and the wonders that God has done. That's the first and the best job of parents, to teach faithfulness. And the best way to teach faithfulness is by living faithfully, by showing people how to love in the Lord. The other two psalms that were read today actually are psalms about God as Father. They describe God's love as a parent, as a father for us. Psalm 68 describes God as Father of the fatherless, protector of orphans and widows. In other words, God gives everyone a home. God adopts us and cares for us. God adopts everyone and cares for everyone. And God gives the desolate a home to live in. God favors those who are in need. God protects, God provides, God shelters, God sustains. God loves as a father loves. And our call is to follow in the image of God. We know this to be true, that God protects the most vulnerable. Those who did not have a father on earth, a good father on earth, or a present father on earth, most definitely have a welcoming father in God Almighty. And we who were blessed with wonderful fathers, and many of us are such, we recognize the love of God in that love, in the fathers who represent it for us. We are grateful for the care and the comfort of a God who loves us. This is good news for everyone. So thanks be to God. The last of today's psalms is Psalm 103. And again, we heard only a few verses from that longer passage. It's a psalm of thanksgiving to God, our Creator and Redeemer, in the context of our mortal lives of dust. The scripture says, "For as the heavens are high above the earth, so great is God's steadfast love toward those who fear him." as far as the east is from the west, which is as far as you can get. So far, God removes our transgressions from us. These verses are often traditionally used around a prayer of confession. And perhaps you have memories of times past when these were used in worship. We remember how much God loves us and how far God will go to save us. To illustrate that overwhelming love of God, that selfless love of God, the psalm uses the example of the good father. As a father has compassion for his children, so the Lord has compassion for us. And we know what that means. We know what a loving father is, especially if we've had one. Think of the compassion of a good father, the passion, the power, the protectiveness, the tenderness, the forgiveness, the guidance, the giving of a good father. We know what the love of a good father is, whether we've had that father or not. We know what it means. God loves us like a good father loves. And even more than that, even more than we can imagine, God loves us. On this Father's Day, we understand the love of God. We see the love of God reflected in the loving fathers around us in the world, in our lives. And for all of that, we give thanks. So as you go out today, if you are a father, thank you. And God bless you. And as Scripture advises, model your fatherhood on the love of God as well. If you are able to speak to or to see your father today, again, give thanks to God. And for you are most richly blessed to be able to connect with your father today. If, on the other hand, you are missing a father today or you didn't have a good father in your life, if you struggle in any way on this Father's Day, know also now and always that you are loved by God, that we do have a wonderful Father in our God Almighty. And those ways that God loves us cannot be measured or contained. God offers us, all of us, grace this day, wherever we stand in life. And God offers us grace and love throughout our lives. Our call is to share that joy and that blessing today. And any way that you are able, share that love of God. And we do so in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Treasure, how great.
Gracious God, we give thanks for the silent prayers of our hearts. We know that you hear our needs and our concerns, even when we don't know how to express them. Lord, we are grateful for your grace this day and every day. We pray all this in the name of Jesus, who taught us to pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever.
Thank you so much for joining us in the service today. If you would please stand if you're able to and join us in our final song.
Of the Holy Spirit be with you now and evermore. Amen.